say to walk inside the void like a kid inside a cave. Discovering the patterns of my soul and where it's placed. I've been mapping many caverns, but it still feels like a maze. I know I'm made of clay that's worn, blinded by imperfect form, but I will trust the art. Find a perilous ravine, carved within the beauty, the darkness in between. Standing in the balance of complete and incomplete, I identify the echo of what is and what will be.
Outside to be beside you all night long. the stars talking about us, saying I would marry you, and that's 'cause I knew there was no one else before you even cared. We've gone up and down, but always been together, like you've been beside me now forever.
Began in the dark of the night, when the people dwelling in darkness would see the light. I bring good news of great joy, was the angel's decree. The Messiah has come, born to rescue and born to lead. He is the herald of hope for all mankind, God made flesh, fully man, yet fully divine. And some called him crazy, but it's hard to deny the water to wine or the open blind eyes. The way his hands healed the broken, the way his voice could calm a storm, the way his eyes held the promise of a people reborn. When they looked to the sun, they saw the God who's unseen, the embodiment of purpose for every created thing. All things made by him, through him, and for him, and only his death could restore mankind to him. Like the grain of wheat that falls to the ground, so that by its seed, new life may be found. He was the seed sown into the dark, that God and man no longer be apart. The gospel, good news of a battle won, the breaking news that all of history hinges upon, and this is the biggest headline ever written. Your debt has been paid, and your sins forgiven.
Then he breathed his last and bowed his head, the Son of God and man was dead. With bloody hands, tears on their face, they laid him down inside that grave. But that wasn't the end. But that wasn't the end. But that wasn't the end. Let me tell you what happened next. The women came before the dawn. Inside, the angel said,
sufficient. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destined.
Come on, church, we sing it. All praise.
All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and nevermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name. Preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagined, ears have heard, or eyes have seen. I believe that day is coming, he's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar, keep it burning, see the Lamb who rules a roaring lion. All praise to God. Spirit, our God has overcome.
was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. From the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had won.
Celebrating your resurrection on that first Easter morning. Lord, we thank you for what you did on Good Friday, that you gave your blood for us. You paid the debt that we couldn't pay. And now, Lord, we're here to celebrate the victory that you won when you walked out of the grave 3 days later. Lord, we love you. We're grateful for you. I pray that you'd be here in our midst as we worship this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said together, Amen, amen. You may be seated. Good morning, church family. Great to see you guys here. Happy Easter to you. It's a pleasure to be able to spend an hour with you together this morning. My name is Van. I'm the senior pastor here, and we just want to say welcome to Cedar Crest Church. And let's have a little fun this morning, okay? He's alive, so here's what we're going to do. I'm going to say, he is risen, and you just yell back at me, he is risen indeed. Can we do that together? Okay, great. Ready? Here we go. One, two, three. He is risen. Come on, one more time. He is risen. Out of way, 8 o'clock. Come on. We're awake and alive. I love it. Man, we're here to celebrate this morning. So if you've never been to church before, welcome to the celebration. It's a party at church. You thought you were just going to take a nap for an hour. Nope. We're going to have some fun. To the moms and dads, that you may be a guest with us today and you weren't quite sure about checking your kids into our amazing kids ministry that's going on right now, just want to let you know you can still do that. You can slip out and check them in. They're going to be having a lot of fun, having fun outside, inside, all sorts of great things going on. But if you choose to keep your kids in the service with you, the only thing that we ask is that they begin to get a little noisy or anxious or rambunctious, that you would stand up and exit our service so that you're not a distraction to those around you. We'll have TVs in the lobby, and you can continue to follow along with the service out there while your kids run laps and wear themselves out from all the Easter candy that they probably already had this morning. Here's what I want to ask. Would you get this card out for me? Everybody that came in should have received one of these. Just grab it for just a second. Just please humor me. Take a look at it while I talk about it. I want to point out a few important things on this card. What we do with this particular card, we do this one time a year. We're going to ask some information of you. We plan sermon series around what's on here. We want to know what you're facing in life, some things that we could speak on from a biblical perspective that would be helpful to you. Also, just things like, how long have you been at Cedar Crest? That's helpful for us because we've added over 500 people to our church in just the last 12 months. So we're growing, God's moving here. And so just being able to know, hey, how long have people been around? That'll help us know what we need to be communicating. But the most important thing is probably here at the bottom of where it says response card, there's a place where for prayer requests. We want you to know that if there's anything going on in your life, every single one of these prayer requests is going to be prayed over specifically. We've got a whole team of people. They're going to be coming up over the next few days, and we'll be laying hands on these cards and specifically lifting up anything going on in your life. So if it's something financial, relational, something going on at work, something happening at school, don't hesitate to write that prayer request down there and know that we're going to be specifically praying for that. Now, you can fill in as much or as little of your contact information as you would like to, as you feel comfortable doing. Obviously, if you need us to update your contact information, make sure you put your name and your new address or email or whatever that might be so that we can update that in our system. But again, prayer request, probably the most important thing that you would look at. One more thing is on the bottom of the backside where it says the Easter survey, there's an A, B, C, and D. Now, that's not to grade my sermon later, okay? So don't think that's not it. So just leave that blank for now, and I'm going to come back to that at the very end of the service. So hold on to this card. Don't stick it in the offering bucket in just a moment. When it comes by, you keep it. And then when we finish our service, I'll go over what that is, and then you can drop them in a basket on your way out the door at the end of the service. So again, thank you guys so much for being here. We're going to continue in worship by having a time of giving. This is a time where those of us that call Cedar Crest home give back a portion of what God's blessed us with. If you're a guest, please don't feel any obligation to give this morning, although you're welcome to do that if you'd like to. And for those of you that are wondering, well, what do you do with this money? I mean, where does it go? Well, we do a lot of things, many of which is outside the walls of this building. We believe that the kingdom of heaven is not just for inside the walls of the church, but is for also into our community and even other nations in the earth. So just a couple of things that we've done. Back in Thanksgiving, we fed over 1,000 families a Thanksgiving meal that were under-resourced in our community. Just last week, we went into 3 different local schools and we fed the faculty and staff of those schools just as a way to say, hey, we're praying for you. Thank you for serving in our community. Jesus loves you. We also found a people group in another nation that did not have the Bible in their native language. And so we took your generosity and we put that towards translating the New Testament into their language for the first time ever. There's those just a few of the things that we do with what's given here on any given weekend. And so again, I just want to say thank you for those of you that are already being generous on a weekend and a week out basis. But for all of us, let's pray together before we receive the offering. The ways to give will be on the screen, but let's ask God to bless it and multiply it and continue to build his kingdom. Would you pray with me? Lord, as we give this morning, it's our act of worship to you. It is just a continuation of what we've already been doing this morning, making much of you. This is not a way for us to kind of pay you off for something that we did last night or last week or just because we feel guilty. A bucket comes by, I guess we better put something in that. No, this is worship, Lord. This is our way of saying we trust you. And so take what's given today, multiply it, use it to build your kingdom. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello and welcome to Cedar Crest. My name is Kelly, and we are so happy you chose to spend your Easter weekend with us. We want you to be a part of what God is doing at Cedar Crest. So here's how you can get involved. At Cedar Crest, we desire to be a Jesus church. We live that out through our four key values: encounter, disciple, serve, and impact. If you haven't found a church home, we would love for you to come and learn more about us and how you can get involved here through Growth Track. Growth Track is where you can hear our vision and values, discover your giftings, and get involved with us. Growth Track kicks off on April 7th. Head to our website for more information. We are passionate about the next generation, and we wanted to let you know about what we have to offer every week for your kids and teenagers. I have the honor of serving on our kids team, and we have programming at all of our Sunday morning services for your infant through fifth grader. We provide a safe and fun environment where kiddos get to participate in dynamic worship and age-appropriate Bible teaching, with application, of course. Also in Cedar Crest Kids, we have a space called Blossom, where kiddos with special needs can be loved on and encounter Jesus. And did I mention fun? Because we have a whole lot of that. Speaking of fun, for sixth grade and above, we go out of our way to create an awesome space for your middle schoolers and high schoolers to encounter Jesus, make new friends, and be equipped with practical biblical tools to take on life with confidence. Middle school meets at 9:30, 11, and 12:30 on Sundays, and high school meets at 4:30 p.m. on Sunday evenings. Sunday, April 7th, we are kicking off a new sermon series called Asking for a Friend. This series will answer some of life's big questions. Join us as we discover what the Bible has to say about why bad things happen to good people. Can we even trust the Bible? And more. So invite your neighbors, invite your friends. We can't wait to see you on April 7th. Kids Camp is June 24th through 27th right here at Cedar Crest. This is a week of fun, games, and learning about Jesus for your rising first grader through rising fifth grader. Registration is open now. Head to our website for more information and to register your kiddos. If you're a guest with us today, first of all, we're so honored that you're here. Second of all, we have a gift for you. Come see our team in the next room or visit the tent on the patio after the service. We would love to meet you and get you that gift. Thank you for choosing to spend your Easter with us.
Well, again, happy Easter to everybody. Again, so grateful that you would take an hour out of your time to worship Jesus with us, spend Easter, your Easter with us. It's going to be an incredible rest of your morning as well. I'm sure beautiful weather outside today. Man, it's going to be awesome. And you're kicking it off the right way as we remember what happened to Jesus on this day in history. He walked out of the grave. He's alive. And we get to celebrate that today. Yeah, that's worth a hand clap. Yeah, come on. And man, if you've been around with us this weekend, you know that on Good Friday, we started by remembering the cross. And what we talked about of Good Friday, what was so important about that is that Jesus gave his life to forgive a debt that you and I couldn't pay. You see, we have a life debt that we owed because of the brokenness in our life. The things that we do that break relationship with God, things we've done intentionally and unintentionally, it's like a toxic waste that just builds up in our lives. And we try as best we can to be a better person. And well, I'm not going to do that anymore. And I'm going to turn my back on that, walk it, and we just never have enough strength to get there. So God in his love for us said, hey, I'm going to take care of that for you. And so Jesus went to the cross. And here's the little phrase that we talked about on Good Friday. Jesus gave his life to forgive us, but he suffered on the cross to reveal his depth of love for us. The cross is really about love. You see, his death, that could have just been transactional. That could have been a cold transaction. It's just, okay, I'm going to give my life for your life just to make everything right again. But his suffering reveals that he is relationally involved with us. He is longing to walk with us in relationship. He suffered for you and he suffered for me, and that's a big deal. But that was just the first half of the story. The second half of the story is that he walked out of the grave alive and was seen by over 500 people on 11 different occasions. And so this morning, I want to talk a little bit about that. Now, when I was almost done with college, this was the late 90s, I went to Baylor University. Some of you guys know that. I was a walk-on football player there. And so I just loved hanging around all these guys that had all this talent. I don't even know what I was doing there, but I made it somehow onto the team. So we had our own workout space. We had a weight room just for the football team. And sometimes some other athletes from other teams would be in there, but it was not usual to see people that I didn't know. But one particular summer, I was in there working out, and this guy comes in. He's about an inch shorter than me, just about as skinny as I am, and I just kind of assumed, okay, maybe he's another wide receiver, a new guy I'd never seen before, but he looked a little older, so I was like, I don't know, maybe he graduated right before I got here. I didn't know who he was, but we're in there, and there's just a handful of us in there working out at this particular day, and it was kind of a, hey, man, you know, what's up, you know, and just we didn't really engage in conversation, just kind of doing our thing, and then he left, and not long after he left, one of my other teammates came up to me and said, Van, do you know who that was? And I was like, no, I assumed he's either new on the team or, you know, something. He's like, no, man, that's Michael Johnson. Now, for those of you that weren't alive in the late 90s, Michael Johnson ran the 200 meters and the 400 meters in the Olympics here in Atlanta in 1996 wearing gold track spikes because the man could fly. I mean, he called it, I'm about to win gold, and he did in both the 200 and the 400. Michael Johnson was an incredible track athlete, and he was a graduate of Baylor. He was back in town. This was after the Olympics, and he was meeting up with his old college track coach there at Baylor, and he was getting ready for his next events, I'm sure. But I have been in the presence of an amazing athlete, a double gold medalist in Atlanta, guy set world records, and I had no idea. I had an opportunity to engage him in conversation and just ask him his story and maybe even take a picture with him. I don't think we did selfies back in the 90s, but if we did, I would have. I mean, just, wow, what an amazing opportunity, and I blew it. Have you ever been kind of either near someone that you didn't realize they were famous and you missed an opportunity to say hello, or maybe you were in a location and you left and then you heard later that like the king and the queen arrived and they were there, you know, ate dinner, right, where you ate it, whatever the thing might have been. There's this thing that we just know, oh man, I missed an opportunity. I could have said hello. I could have gotten a selfie. I should have just walked over and asked for the autograph or whatever the thing is. But sometimes we're completely unaware that we are in the presence of someone who's done something absolutely amazing. Well, believe it or not, this very thing happened to Mary Magdalene, who was one of the followers of Jesus. The day that he rose from the dead, Mary had an encounter with him and had no idea that it was him because she was so shocked with the fact that there was nobody in the grave. And so this morning, I want to actually read you the story. We're going to read out of the book of John. This was, of course, written by the disciple of Jesus, John. Jesus had 12 guys that we refer to normally as the disciples. These were the apostles, the ones that really built the church. But there was a larger group of disciples as well that included other guys, as well as some ladies, you know, Mary Magdalene, who we're going to read about, Mary the mother of Jesus, and others. And it says specifically that the ladies actually funded the work that Jesus and the disciples were up to out of their own means. And so the 12 would go out on these tours to share the gospel, and Jesus would preach, and they would be healing people, but these ladies were the ones actually financially supporting the work. And so Mary Magdalene was a very close associate of Jesus. She would have been not in the very inner circle of the 12, but just kind of in that next circle of acquaintances. And so John, who writes this down, he was one of the 12. He's going to refer to himself, just so you know, he's going to refer to himself in this as the other disciple. So he's talking about himself a little bit in third person. That way, when I read it, you'll kind of know who John's talking about. So let's read it. John chapter 20, verse 1, where Mary has this experience of not knowing she's in the presence of Jesus. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. So this is John's way of just saying, I'm faster than Peter, okay? So no theological significance there. John just wanted to brag on himself. So there we go. Verse 5. He bent over and he looked in the strips of linen were lying there, but he did not go in. And then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb, and he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, just don't forget that, I'm faster, John says here, I also went inside, and he saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. And then the disciples went back to where they were staying. So here's the picture. John and Peter raced to the tomb. John wants to make sure that we understand he was there first. He's faster. But then Peter went in and checked it out. And then John goes in. And now they're both like, he's not here. Now remember, they seen him nailed to a cross on Good Friday. That John was there. Now, Peter and the other disciples were hiding, but John, we know from other places in the gospel, John was standing there with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Mary Magdalene and others, and they watched him die. They watched a spear go into his side and be pulled out and blood and water flow out. He was dead. And they put his body in a borrowed tomb, and Roman soldiers were assigned to stand their guard over this tomb. Now they arrive early on Sunday morning, and the guards are gone. The stone has been rolled away. That weighed a couple of tons, by the way. It's been rolled back, and the tomb that Jesus' body was put in is empty, and the only thing left are the cloths, the linens that he was wrapped in. So they take off, and they run back to where the other guys are. But let's pick it up in verse 11 with Mary. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." And at this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Can you imagine just the scene? I think I want to give Mary a little bit of grace. She's in absolute shock. She saw the horror of what Jesus went through. She saw his body beaten to a pulp. She saw him dead, put into this tomb, and she knew it was being guarded, and now they get there, and the body's gone. There's nobody in the grave, and nobody expected nobody in the grave. And so as she's there, she's in shock. Jesus begins speaking to her, and it's kind of one of these like, just, you must be the gardener. Where have you put him? Like, where is he? If you know where he is, just tell me and I'll find him. And what I find so inviting about Mary's experience is oftentimes this is your experience and my experience. The whirlwind of life is happening around us all the time. I got to get the kids out the door to school. Oh, I got to handle this thing at work. We got a crisis at work. I'm going to have to stay late. Honey, won't be home for dinner. Our marriage is falling apart. We got to get help right now. You know, there's always some pressure point or stress or thing that we're worried about or we're working on. And I call that the whirlwind of life that's always going on. And meanwhile, Jesus, who's alive and has every answer that we could ever need and has all the provision that we could ever need, is literally standing there and just waiting for someone to recognize, hey, I'm here. If you'll just call on me, if you'll recognize that I'm here, I've got everything that you need. And yet we so often miss Jesus because the whirlwind distracts us from the quiet comfort that comes through the Holy Spirit, the person of Jesus. If you know anything about the Bible, or if you grew up in church, perhaps you've heard the story of Elijah. Elijah was a prophet in the Old Testament. He was a man of God. He heard directly from God. God would speak to him on behalf of the whole nation of Israel. But he had a moment where he fell into a deep depression, and he began to doubt that anyone else was worshiping God. He was basically like, God, I'm the only one left. I'm the only faithful one left. And now people are out to get me. They're going to kill me. Will you just take my life? And he runs off, and he's hiding in a cave up on a mountain. And God says, I'm going to reveal myself to you. And so he comes by in his power, and there's this mighty wind that blows against the mountain. And then there's an earthquake that literally shakes the foundation of the mountain. And then there's this burning fire that happened. I mean, imagine if like a volcano was erupted, just this wind and earthquake and fire. But the scripture says the Lord was not in the wind. He was not in the earthquake, and he was not in the fire. And then he began to speak to Elijah in a gentle whisper. And I believe that that's, again, such an amazing picture of what Mary experienced and what you and I experienced. The whirlwind happening. Where's God? You know, what's going on? And oftentimes, he's right next to us, just gently whispering. But because we're so busy, because we just run from one thing to the next, all of us are busy. And we're just always, it's the next thing. We got to get to this. We got to do this. Sometimes it's entertainment. Sometimes it's a work thing. Sometimes I'm volunteering somewhere. You're just, we're always go, 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 go. And we run right by Jesus, who's just gently whispering, hey, I've got everything that you need. Are you aware of his presence? Here's what you need to know, whether you've been walking with God for years, you say, I'm a Christian, or whether you say, man, I never go to church. I came this morning to keep peace in the family, and hopefully I'll get a good meal out of it later because I was a good person. I got dressed, I put on my dress, or I put on my nice Sunday clothes, or whatever the thing. And whatever you are on the spectrum, if you just showed up to keep the peace, or you'd say that you love God, we're all at risk of running past Jesus if we're not careful. The cares of the world that take over. Well, Mary, again, she is a devoted follower of Jesus. But in the moment of stress, she was so caught up in what was going on, she missed that he was standing right there, thought he was the gardener. Now, what I love about this, that she thinks he's the gardener, is that actually, I would say, Jesus is the gardener of your soul. This is part of who God is. Think about the first book of the Bible in Genesis. It says, when God created this earth, and he created man and woman, where did he put them? He put them in the Garden of Eden. That's what God did. And it says that in those days before sin came in, before there was a breach of the relationship between us and God, it said that God would walk with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day in the garden. It's who he is. He's a creator, and he's planting seeds all the time that bring life and bring refreshing. So much so is this a theme of who God is that Jesus would even share a parable. A parable is a story that Jesus would tell those that he was teaching to try to show them something, a deep spiritual truth. And so he talked about a farmer who went out to sow seeds, or you could think of it as a gardener that went out to sow seeds. And he shared this story, and everyone that heard it was like, I don't understand what you just said. So his disciples pull him aside after and say, hey, Jesus, could you explain that to us again? And so Jesus explained the parable of the seed sower. And this is what he said. He said, I am the gardener. I'm the farmer. I'm the one that's sowing the seed. And the seed that I'm sowing is the gospel, which means it's the good news. It's the answer that you need for what you're facing in life. It's the purpose that you're longing to fulfill. It's the wisdom of how to raise your kids. I'm sowing seed all of the time, but there's different types of soil. And specifically, Jesus said there's four types of soil that represents your hearts and my heart. And he said, this is the meaning of the different of the four soils. So I want you to think through, which soil am I? Which soil is my soul? If Jesus is the gardener and he's sowing seed, what kind of soil is it falling on in your life? He said the first type of soil is actually not much soil at all. It's just a hard path. And it's just been rolled over with cars and carts and people and animals. And so when the seed falls on that, it's just hard, and people step on it and they crush it, and the bird comes along and takes it and just immediately removes it. In other words, there's no fertile place for that love of God to fall on that soul. And so it's immediately snatched away. There's a second type of soil that Jesus said. He said it's rocky soil. So there's some soil there, but there's also this rockiness to it. There's not a lot of depth to it. So the seed falls on it, and it sprouts up quickly with joy, but because it lacks depth, the minute there's a pushback in life, the minute there's any sort of challenge in life, and by the way, we all face challenge, so the minute that challenge comes, it takes away the fruit. It takes away the seed that was planted. There's a third type of soil, and he said this soil is actually good soil as well, but as the seed sprouts and begins to bear fruit in your life, thorns grow up with it and choke it off and kill it. And what are the thorns? Jesus said the thorns are the cares of this world. It's the pursuit of riches. It's the anxiety that comes as we chase after the whirlwind. And he said, when we allow the things of this world to choke out his good message, then even though we have good soil, it doesn't survive. The purposes of God in our life don't make it. And he said, but there's a fourth soil. And the fourth soil is good soil. And it's a soil that when the seed is planted, that it grows and it produces a crop 100-fold. I wonder what you would say about your own soul and the soil condition of your soul as God is the gardener wanting to plant seeds there. Is there a receptive garden in your own heart for what God wants to do? Again, he's got everything that you need. Everything that you're kind of chasing after in the whirlwind, everything that I chase after in the whirlwind, it actually all comes from the gardener, Jesus, who loves to have a relationship with us. And he said, if you'll just take a break from the whirlwind. But here's the thing, and I'm not saying we neglect the whirlwind. There are things in the whirlwind that are actually needed. Like, you've got to put food on the table, so go to work. You know, like, you've got to graduate from school. So kids, graduate, get good grades. Like, your parents want you to graduate, so do I, so did Jesus. Like, that's part of the whirlwind, and I know we don't like it, but that's a necessary part of life. But the question is the whirlwind owning you? Is that your whole mindset? It's always focused on this. Or do you look to Jesus first and say, Jesus, now I've got some responsibilities. Can you help me? Can you give me strength? Can you give me wisdom? Can you guide me through the maze of this life? It matters, especially in the Bible Belt. We have what I call unsaved Christians. Now, I know that may sound weird. What do I mean by that? It's people that say, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. I know, I go to church every now and then, you know. But Jesus is an add-on. He's the bumper sticker on your car. It's, Lord, help me with the whirlwind. You know, it's just add on to your life. And it's never intended to be that way. The person that truly understands who the gardener is, that truly understands the one that gave his life for us, and then put the exclamation point on the victory of the cross when he walked out of the grave on Easter Sunday, the person that truly understands that puts Jesus first above everything. And then the beautiful thing about it, when you do that, everything else begins to make sense. Your marriage makes sense. Your parenting makes sense. The financial provision that you need begins to fall into place because Jesus promises to provide for us all of our needs according to his riches and glory. So literally everything that we need is with the gardener. Are you living for the whirlwind? Are you living for Jesus? What kind of soil is in your own heart or in your own soul? Jesus told the story of the four soils because that represents all of us. And the question is, are we recognizing what kind of soil that we have? Well, Mary, in this moment, she's involved in the whirlwind. She doesn't even realize that Jesus is standing there. She thinks he's the gardener. And then in verse 16, it says this, Jesus said to her, Mary, he called her by name, and she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. And Jesus said, do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God. And Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. This amazing moment where she, you know, it's kind of, this guy's there. Oh, he must be the gardener. And when he says Mary, it says that she looked at him. And then she realized it. Rabboni, teacher, it's you, Jesus. She had this moment of revelation. And what I love about this story about Mary is that we remember that Jesus died for all, but he calls us individually. Do you know that God wants to have a relationship with you specifically, individually. This is the beautiful thing about it. He died for everybody, but he calls you individually. He created you uniquely and individually, knit you together specifically for a purpose in this life. And he is the gardener who's spreading the seed. It's just like, if you'll just turn your heart's attention in my direction, I've got all the answers that you need. I open the doors that you need to be open. And even when you go through the valley of the shadow of death, you won't have to fear any evil because I will be with you. With you specifically. This is such a big deal that Paul in Galatians 2, chapter 20 said, you know, Jesus died for me. He gave his life for me. I wonder, do you know Jesus like that? Do you know him? Not just know about him up here. There's a lot of people in the South that know about him, but do you know him? He offers relationship. And then once he calls you, he gives you purpose and mission in life. And the first thing that he said to Mary was, go tell my boys, go tell the 12, go tell them that I'm alive. Now, I love that. That Mary got the privilege to preach the first Easter sermon. I can't wait to meet Mary in heaven. Come on, oh, the OG preacher on Easter, she goes and shares the message. And what's beautiful about this part of the story, just by the way, in case you're kind of like, well, is this true? Can we really believe this? If you wanted to make up a lie, and 2,000 years ago, you never would have said a woman was the first eyewitness. And the reason for, I'm not knocking ladies, but the reason for that is, in that day and age, a woman's testimony was not believed. It was not admissible in a court of law. If you wanted to prove something, you wouldn't ask a woman to speak it out. You'd have to find some guy. So this is actually one of the reasons we know this must be true, because the only reason you would say that Mary did it is because it actually happened that way. And so Mary goes off and she shares the story, and lives are beginning to change. And we know that what happened from here, they went from a group of about 100 or so people scared to death, hiding, thinking what Rome did to Jesus, they're going to come do to us now. They went from that to exploding. Over 3,000 people added to their number on one day, preaching with boldness. The church began to grow. And what started as just a little group that the scripture refers to as followers of the way in the armpit of the world, under the thumb of the Roman Empire, blossomed into the greatest movement the world has ever seen. Spread to every nation, every tribe, every tongue, every socioeconomic background, every ethnicity, young and old, men and women. This truth that Jesus is alive has changed lives for centuries. And very smart people, people that are skeptics, have looked into the evidence of the resurrection. The fact that there is no body. Well, maybe the authorities took it. Well, the minute the church began to grow, all they had to do is present his body, and it's over, it's squashed, but there was no body. Well, maybe his followers took it. Well, if the followers took it, why would they then boldly give their life? Many of them killed in brutal ways because they proclaimed that Jesus was alive. Now, if you know you've got him buried in your own backyard and you stole his body, are you going to die like that? Probably not. There was nobody in the tomb. The radical growth of the church, people through generations like you and me that have experienced the power of the living God in our own life through the person of the Holy Spirit over and over again. This changed the world, man. This is not just some like, hey, that's a nice little bedtime story that we tell each other once a year at Easter. Isn't it great? Let's go eat some chocolate eggs and then it's done till next year. No, he's alive. And if he's alive, that changes everything. That changes everything. So here's what happens. Here's what happens. So I got to move quick, right? We got 3 more services to go, and I got to get you out of here on time. But I just love it because he's alive, and there's so much power in this. I don't want you to miss it, because some of you are sitting here thinking, well, okay, you know, it's your job to get excited, so I get it. You know, that's what you do for a living. No, man, don't walk out of this room thinking Jesus was just some good moral teacher. You actually can't say that Jesus was a good moral teacher. What he said and what he did does not leave us with that option. He was either a liar, a lunatic, or he was Lord. And C.S. Lewis, who was an amazingly smart man, he taught at Oxford and Cambridge. He wrote a book called Mere Christianity. And if some of the claims of Christianity are hard for you to kind of grasp, this is a book I'd recommend, Mere Christianity. But this is what C.S. Lewis said about the person that's kind of wrestling with, well, maybe he's just a good moral teacher. He said, I'm trying here to prevent anyone saying the really foolish thing that people often say about Jesus, that I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher. But I don't accept his claim to be God. This is the one thing we must not say. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He'd either be a lunatic on the level with the man who says he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. But let's not come up with so many patronizing nonsense about him being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us, and he did not intend to. And so wherever you might be today, the wrestle is, who do I really think he is? He was either lying, meaning he knew he wasn't the Son of God and he said he was to try to get a bunch of followers and get, you know, some money out of the deal. Or he was crazy, so he's saying he's the Son of God because he believes he is, but he's really not. Or on that Easter Sunday, he really walked out of the grave. He predicted his own death, burial, and resurrection and then pulled it off, which says he's Lord. And not only is he Lord, he is who he says he is, and he'll do what he says he will do in your life. Because there's nobody in the grave, you can know that he's alive and active. Because there's nobody in the grave, you can have relationship with him. Because there's nobody in the grave, you can have purpose for your life. Because there's nobody in the grave, all fear is gone. And because there's nobody in the grave, he holds the future. And because there's nobody in the grave, he's here present with us right now. And the question is your heart open to the seed that's being sown, that God is speaking to you right now? Even through my words, God is just spreading seed right now. And where there's soil that will receive it, there's a hundredfold return that can be had in your life of knowing the living God. And I don't want anybody here that's even the least bit open to that, to leave without having an opportunity to respond to that. So here's what I want to ask you to do. Would you take this card again that you have? If you'll just take this out and look at it just for a moment. Even if you've done this with us before, maybe been at Cedar Crest for years, this is the opportunity where you're not going to grade my sermon, but we are going to look at the A, B, C, and D, okay? And here's why we're going to do this. As I've been saying all morning, if you walked out of this 1 hour, you spent a precious hour of your time here today. And if I let you leave here without knowing where you stand with God, then I would be the worst preacher in the history of preaching. And so I want to give you an opportunity to know exactly where you stand. Now, it's your choice where you stand, but I want to give you that opportunity. Here's the situation. Jesus loves us, but there's brokenness in our relationship with him. It's called sin. So he went to the cross to pay the debt for us. But he gives us this beautiful picture. He says, I'm standing at the door of your life and I'm knocking. And if anyone hears my voice and opens that door, I will come in and I will have fellowship with you. And so it's all about, again, our heart getting off of the whirlwind and looking to Jesus, who would long to have relationship with anyone in here. And if you want to open that door, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that. Here's what these letters mean. And I want to ask every single one of you to check one of the boxes. You're just going to check one based on where you are today. I just want you to be honest between yourself and with God. And here's what the boxes mean. The A stands for I already have relationship with Jesus. Hey, thank you, Pastor. Appreciate the encouragement. Do I get some candy on the way out the door today for Easter? Yes, you do. We've got chocolate, so just find someone in a green shirt. They've got candy for you. Glad you came. Love you. He's risen. All right, good job. You already got relationship with Jesus. The B is for the person that says, hey, I want to begin a relationship with Jesus. Maybe it's your first time in church. Maybe you've come to church for years, but something you heard today, you're just like, that made sense for the first time. You feel in your heart an openness to the message of Jesus for the first time. You see, the scripture says he's drawing us with cords of loving kindness. And so if you want to begin a relationship with Jesus today, I'm going to ask you to check B. Some of you used to be, quote unquote, in a relationship with God, but you walked away from that. And life got busy. Maybe the thorns of life came up and they've choked off the thing that God had planted in your life. And you say, man, I need to begin again. I need to start over with Jesus. I wanna come back to following him. And so whether you're beginning for the first time or you wanna begin again, I want you to check B. And I'm gonna come back to that in just a moment. We're gonna pray a prayer together. C is for the person that says, I wanna consider what I've heard today. Hey, you've mentioned that there's some evidence around the resurrection, and I'd like to read a little bit more about that, The Case for Christ, Mere Christianity. Those are two books that would be great to go and read a little bit more about what I've been talking about. This again, is not just some made up, you know, just fable. There's historic eyewitness accounts to the things that I'm talking about in the Bible, outside the Bible. So you consider it if that's where you are. D is for the person that says, I don't plan to ever follow Jesus. And here's what I want to say. If that's you, please be honest with yourself and check that box. Last year, across all of our services, we had 8 individuals check D. And here's what I want you to know. If you're sitting in the room and you're going to check D today, man, I'm so glad you came. The fact that you came today, just thank you for sharing an hour with us. Thank you for letting me share this truth that has changed my life and changed so many others. But if you check D, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. I'm going to get all of those cards, and I'm going to be praying specifically for you. Those 8 cards that checked D last year, I've been praying, not every day, but on and off. Lord, would you meet them? Would you encounter them? Would you reveal yourself to be real in their life? Here's what I'd say. What do you have to lose, right? If you're right, God doesn't exist, and all this is just made up, then no skin off your back for checking D. But if I'm right, then I get a chance to pray for you. So if that's you, you just check D. One of those places, though, check 1, and then on the way out here at the end of our service, just drop it in the basket. And I want to come back to the person that checked B. This is an opportunity for you to open the door to Jesus right now as we finish our time together. I'm going to pray with you, and then we're going to sing one final song of celebration to end our service. But let's just have a moment of prayer. Would you bow your head with me just right where you are? And if in your own heart you just know, hey, man, this is my day to begin. It's as simple as a prayer that says, sorry, thank you, and please. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray that prayer, and just I want to ask you just agree with me in your own heart. If your desire is to begin a relationship with him, sorry, thank you, and please. Lord Jesus, we are sorry for the things that we have done intentionally and unintentionally that have broken relationship with you. But thank you for the cross. Thank you, God, that you went to the cross and you paid a debt that I could not pay. You shed your blood to forgive me, and you suffered showing how much you loved me. Thank you for the cross. Lord, now I simply ask you to please come into my life. I want to begin a relationship with you. I open the door of my life as best I know how, and I turn my heart's attention to you, and Lord, I ask you to come into my life. Now, if you just agreed with me in that prayer and you turn in this card, if you put your email on there, we want to send you a digital booklet that will help you take some first steps in following Jesus. And so, Lord, I pray for anyone that can hear my voice online and in this room right now that's opening the door of their life. Would you come in? Would you fill them with the Holy Spirit? Would you give them everything that they need to follow you? And, Lord, may all of us know you and the power of your resurrection today. May we be reminded that when we put you first, that everything else falls into place. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your precious holy name we pray. Amen.
Emblem of a reason. so much more. Sun rose day three, new life, new me. We are set free. Was told in the dark, speak in the daylight. A soft muted word, shout from the rooftop. Turn down the noise, drown out that nonsense. Get up in the night, light up the darkness, and we sing. Light of the darkness. We keep on singing. Won't you light up the darkness?
Dark.